Yeah, Brooke, yeah, you mentioned the gathering that happened. It was up at City Hall. It's about a 15-minute walk from here, and so many people gathered up there that they actually, the organisers actually asked people to start the march or the walk early because there were so many people there, as you say, well over 100,000 people. And they made the 15-minute walk down to the cathedral you can see behind me. It's interesting, Brooke, you know, there is a carpet of flowers there that people are standing around there at the moment. It's going to be 40 yards or so by 20 yards wide. It's just such a moving thing, and flowers were the order of the day. It's a very, very solemn mood around Oslo and indeed all around the country. And there were other marches in other parts of the country as well. People here are really coming together as this tragedy or the fallout from this tragedy continues. Brooke?
And they're coming together because of the horrific events that unfolded just a couple of days ago because of this man. Tell me about Breivik. You were outside the court this morning. I know press cameras were not allowed inside. What did he say? What is next in this legal process?
Yeah, it's interesting. It's a very open judicial system here in Norway. It's a very open society. And the media thought we were going to be able to get in and hear the court hearing. The police asked the judge to make it closed, which is fairly unprecedented. The reason being that they thought that Breivik might use the occasion to send a message to possible co-conspirators on the outside. Breivik apparently has said that he worked with two cells in the organisation of what he carried out on Friday. The judge did then meet with the media afterwards. He actually held a news conference and outlined a lot of the things that Breivik has been saying in the court hearing and also to police. Things like that he pled not guilty, but he did say that he carried out these things. He said he needed to carry them out to save Europe from multiculturalism and Islamic takeover. Extremely radical stuff. He's been remanded in custody for 8 weeks. That's when he'll appear in court again. First 4 weeks of that in solitary. No newspapers, no television, no visitors, just his lawyers. But yeah, a lot of the stuff we've been hearing in that manifesto, just anti-Islamic stuff that he's been saying to police. So yeah, 8 weeks, he'll be back in court. I was talking to a law professor earlier. He said that if the trial goes ahead, as it looks like it will, you might not get a verdict for another year. And as I said, he pled not guilty. Why? Well, by pleading not guilty, he gets a trial and a stage to tell his side of the story, if you know what I mean. He's going to be able to spread more of this, the diatribe that he's come out with, Brooke.
Right. But then the other part of this, the stories that are coming out, the people who did survive, the tales of heroism. Tell me, Michael Holmes, talk to me about this amazing man you met who fortunately had a boat. What was his story?
Yeah. Casper Ilgood is a great guy. We met up with him yesterday up near the island where the shootings happened. He got a call from a friend when these shootings began. He and other people, just local residents, jumped into the boats, went over to the island, while this is all going on, mind you, and started rescuing kids from the shoreline. He took on 14 in his first trip, and it's a pretty small boat. As you'll see, I think we've got a soundbite of a moment that one girl on his boat turned to him. Have a listen.
One of the last trips, one of the girls starts crying and she looked at me and asked, are you police? And I said, no, I'm just a local resident. And she got a little relieved by that and she looked at me and said, you know, it was a policeman with a uniform, with a bald head, who started shooting us.
Yeah, and that's because Breivik, of course, Brooke was pretending to be a policeman when he went to the island. You know, Casper's a lovely guy. And one of the most saddest things, I think, he said, he went there three times, and on the second trip, he saw these kids huddled together, three of them, and he tried to get their attention, and he said they were hiding, they wouldn't move. He went back the next time, and that was when he realized that those kids were dead. I mean, he did amazing things. He took dozens of kids off, and so did the other people, real local.